And please welcome up panelists, all NIFT alumni, Mr. Amit Kumar, Director of Retail Merchandising, Levi Strauss India Limited. Let's put our hands together for Mr. Narendra Kumar Ahmed, Eminent Designer and Creative Director at Amazon.com. Let's welcome our next panelist, Ms. Sunita Shankar. She's already been on stage for the last panel discussion. We welcome her back. A well-known designer and design consultant, Ms. Sunita Shankar. A warm welcome to Mr. Manish Saxena, advisor, Tommy Hilfiger and Amazon.com. Please welcome Ms. Sukanya Datta Roy, Managing Director, Consumer Goods Business, Swarovski, India. And a warm welcome to Mr. Shilpi Sharma, Design Head, Reliance Trends. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, you're in for a very, very interesting panel discussion, and it's over to Dr. Sushil Rathore and Professor Saurav Kumar to take us through this discussion. Over to you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Hingam. We would like to welcome the panel members, and before we start the discussion, we would like to also invite the audience to have an interactive and participative session rather than like being a monologue session. We will start with an introductory remark from all the senior alumni and who are fashion business leaders in their own respective field. We would like to understand from them that when they started their careers, what was the success mantra that they had in their mind and which they followed and they became a fashion leader. So I'll ask them that what are those success mantras. We'll begin with Mr. Amit Kumar, whom I've been interacting since last 10-15 years, and he has been discussing on various platforms regarding what NIFT alumni should do and how should NIFT faculty change their course curriculum. So we have been getting lots of intrinsic aspect of the program, and we have been getting lots of input from him on those areas. So we'll begin the discussion with Mr. Amit Kumar on his success mantra that he has been following. Mr. Amit.
Hi, good evening, everybody. So first of all, Dr. Sushil, thanks for calling us here. And we'd like to share our experiences. Success mantra. So the day I'll find it, I'll tell you. I'm still looking for one. So I think there's a quote by Mark Twain that says, to succeed in life, you should be ignorant and confident. So when I joined NIFT in 1993, I was really, really ignorant about fashion. I think I'm still am. But NIFT really made me confident about that. So 2 years which I spent in NIFT really made me confident about fashion. I really thank all the faculty and all my friends and colleagues there. And that's how I've lived in this industry for 20 years. And also another good thing about fashion industry is that it always gives you a second chance. So every year you're making two or three collections, or you're launching your season after season. You can fail in one season, but you get a chance to get up in the next season. So go with the flow, keep trying, keep your focus, and be ignorant and be confident. That's my success mantra. Thank you.
So again, I would also say I can't really call it a success mantra, but I think I joined NIFT 21 years back because it was something where there was passion for the fashion itself and the product, which led me to do it. And of course, to do something which was untested and untried, that had its own kick. But I think what has proved to be good for me is as I have progressed in my career, the industry has evolved and it has thrown various opportunities at various times. And somehow I think I've been able to be a part of those progressions, a part of those new things that kept happening. So whether it was the coming in of the department stores, coming in of the international brands, coming in of the e-commerce, and I think all those things that kept happening to the industry kept happening to me also, which is what I think has been my biggest benefit in being in an industry which was itself evolving. So that's really how I would define that. Thank you. And of course I should also say, because while I was listening to that inspiring presentation just before that, I do still have a regret that I haven't been able to work with the craft industry in a sort of a very constructive way, which I need to correct sometime soon. Yes.
I graduated in 90 and there was not really any fashion. And so it was a nice way to try and fail and succeed in something or the other. I think my calling was craft, and it was the best thing that happened to me. And I think I was such a restless soul, and fashion or designing, rather than the fashion, I would say designing, has been.
So I'm still trying to find success today, but whatever little I have got was been in stages. I think the first part was being really obsessive about my craft, which was probably the most relevant at that point. So being obsessive about my craft, having a conviction about myself, and finally, I think more important as I got along was being relevant. You have to be relevant at every moment of time, and that's what makes a difference. However great you are, if you're not relevant, makes no sense.
I think I like the question. I like the whole concept of say why you're successful. So it takes some time to answer that, because you're trying to figure out are you really successful. So I passed out in 94, and I took up the course at IF because I had not gotten anywhere else. And I think that was the case for most of us in our batch for AMM. And I think that small step we took actually defined why I said, I would say we are enjoying our careers rather than successful now. We took a chance of a new emerging sector, merchandising. I think the course started with the explanation of what is merchandising for most of us. But on the way, I think what helped us was passion, having fun at what we are doing, and enjoying the industry, being flexible, adapting to changes, and this is one of the industry which changes very fast. And I'm not sure if all this is going to get you success, but you enjoy your journey. And I hope that all of us here are at least enjoying our journey and having fun in what we are doing. And that's a great achievement.
Hi, I'm Shilpi Sharma. I passed out in 1991. You know, first of all, I'd like to thank NIFT for calling me. You know, coming back to NIFT is something which is very, very emotional to me. And I always enjoy coming back. Now, what I can say about myself is I just followed the way, you know, I went with the flow. What about the garment industry? The most interesting thing which I like is there is a lot of creativity, there is a lot of vibrancy, and there is a lot of technology, and there is a lot of economics. And in one small career of ours, if we can, you know, get every part of it, it will keep you going. And I have kept myself going. Being with the export trade, being with, you know, highly technical suit manufacturing industry, then working with, you know, high-end Italian customers, then working with Walmart, Target, Kohl's, then working with Indian retail. So there is always something new which is coming up in this track, which keeps you going. And I would love to keep working till the time, you know, my body is, allows me. And I would say that the success is something which is still to come. But the pleasure of working with the industry is keeping me going. Thanks.
The qualitative remarks and the modesty that all of you have shown, that is the success mantra. In true sense, modesty is the true success mantra. Definitely there can't be a mathematical model, there can't be a formula on the basis of which you can measure success. But now coming to specifics, since all of you are from different field, be it a design or craft or marketing, retail, merchandising, I'll have some specific questions to each one of you, if which would be definitely interesting for all the audience, especially the alumni and the students to know. I have a very specific question for Mr. Amit Kumar, who comes from Levi Brand. And see, when we talk of today's customer, customers are changing in terms of their buying behavior. And the concept of loyalty is no more there. The customers are no more loyalty. The moment a new brand comes in, a customer immediately moves from that brand, irrespective of whatever was your loyalty initially. So we would like to know from your side that how do you take this? Do you take customers not being loyal as an opportunity or as a challenge for a brand that you specifically talk about?
Yeah, so first of all, let's understand why we are seeing change in consumer behavior, or why consumers are changing, or why there is no loyalty. I think it's a lot to do with the environment around, and I like to draw an analogy to cricket, and cricket is the flavor of the day today. Tomorrow, India is playing Bangladesh in the final. So, 30 years back, there was only test cricket, and 30 years back in India, there were only high streets, only a few stores. One used to shop only during Diwali or festive season, Durga Puja in Calcutta or Pongal in South. So people used to only specifically shop for specific time periods, for specific stuff. Also, so people had time to watch a five-day cricket. People used to get their garments stitched. They used to wait for the tailor to take their measurement and make it. So it was like a five-day cricket. Then came one-day cricket. A lot of brands like Levi's and Lee Cooper, Pepe, Benetton, these brands came into the country. And they started changing the face of the industry. There were a lot of, so that was one-day cricket, ready to wear. You go in, one day you get your product in. Then you started getting a lot many more competitions coming up. You had World Cup, you had other ICC championships. So that means more malls started coming up, more stores started coming up, and it became a more prolific thing. Now it's T20, where you're competing with your own people. You've got team members of international players coming and playing with you. You learn their craft. You compete against them, and you compete with them. Otherwise, and T20, you can say, is on your mobile now. That's your internet. It's your Flipkarts and Myntras of the world. So you can just shop there and then. So trends are changing very fast. The consumer is becoming very, very discerning. One thing which is not changing is consumer. He wants quality all the time. And loyalties are shifting. But if you are able to keep giving the right product and at the right price and the best quality to the consumer, they will stick on to you. And they will be loyal to you. And that's what it is. So the environment is changing. The spectators, which is the consumers, they are changing along with the environment, and one has to just keep pace with it and keep evolving and don't compromise on quality, because the consumer will keep coming back.
Thank you, Amit. Amit, you raised a point which is related to technology intervention, because of which you feel that consumers' perceptions or consumers' buying behavior is changing. Related to this, I would like to, since Mr. Manish, you are from the premium, super premium category, you talk about, your brand talks about. Connecting these two dots, I would like to understand from you that what do you think is the scope of premium and super premium brand with specific reference to the e-business, e-commerce business?
I'm actually still learning e-commerce. In the last 3 years, what I have observed is that e-commerce definitely is seen more as a market for sensitive price points, and therefore just something which is for a lower price point, definitely. But I think there is a lot of synergy between premium brands and e-commerce market, because there are certain key metrics which are at work when you talk about a premium brand. Then the first being that there are only certain number of cities, which is probably still only about 30-40 cities out of 1500 cities in India, which provide the retail infrastructure for a premium brand to actually open a store. One problem being on this side, the other being that there aren't enough customers in smaller cities. While they have deep pockets, but there aren't enough customers to be able to make the business sustainable with a standalone store, because there would be only certain few who would keep coming back, and they do not justify the cost of retail. What e-commerce does is to actually reach out to this segmented audience by actually reaching out without really having an infrastructure in each of these cities, and therefore being able to address this audience in a very unique way. And again, similar to this point, I feel also is that there is also a lot of hesitation on the customer front, because they don't necessarily enter a premium store that easily. Then they do a store which is probably more welcoming because of the way it is priced or the way it is, its imagery is. And therefore, what e-commerce again does is that it provides a very unified platform for a customer to experience the product, look at the product, and probably over a period of time find merit in the product to actually be able to go and buy that product, which does not come as an opportunity when it is behind a closed door, which is a big benefit that e-commerce brings to the premium again. And not something which I think is a very key point, but there are certain international brands which are obviously coming in at a very fast pace now. And one would say that every 6 months, the kind of the retail look and feel is changing in the country. But what's also happening is that they are getting disappointed that much faster. Because when they actually are sold the India story, they perhaps think that there is a huge volume waiting there for them. But when they actually come, and then after certain stores and certain cities, they see it getting exhausted. And that's purely because you cannot sort of take it beyond certain stores. But if one was to really use the e-commerce route, I think they can, and use it effectively and market it effectively, I think the returns will be much more evident to them in a much more profitable and a much more efficient manner. Because it, again, for the balancing that it provides, because between the cost and between the retail. So that is yet another big advantage that e-commerce can lend to the premium brands, I think.
Thank you, Manish. Continuing up with our discussion on the e-business, I have a specific question for Mr. Narinder Emmer, who comes from the e-business. We are seeing a speedy, or we are seeing a pace in the e-business as far as the growth of business is then that context. Do you see, gone are the days when we will see a mad rushes are gone, the footfall in the physical store is gone, or it's a long way to go when we see all these physical stores being wiped out from the market? So how do you see, do you think that the days are nearer that the entire footfall from the physical stores would be wiped out?
I don't think that there will be a stage that will come while we are alive when the footfall will drop out, because from stores or offline stores, because I think a lot of people want to still experience the idea of going and shopping, touching, feeling and all that kind of stuff. But when it comes to convenience, e-commerce is going to open doors that for brands that have never been possible before. Like Manish just said, can take you to 19,000 pin codes across this country. No retail store can do that. Yeah? It opens up many possibilities for brands and associate with people. It opens up opportunities for brands to advertise nationally and reach nationally. Otherwise, you are doing advertising for small pockets of people. There are many different things that brand, that e-commerce can do in many ways. Of course, as opposed to something like Amazon, which we would look for about like a 10-year window or 15-year window or 20-year window when you're doing business in India. So we don't look at that kind of thing. But the great thing is opportunities are opening up. A lot of people in smaller towns or cities are coming up to fashion, bringing some of the top brands being sold in small towns in the country. Why should they not have it? I think every brand would like to see their products in. But you're already seeing, I've been talking to a lot of people, and already people are saying that they're seeing a drop in the number of retail spaces opening up, malls opening up, and that kind of stuff. And I've seen that with some of the brands also. But they're being compensated by offline in some way. But I think experience still remains king.
Thank you, Mr. Harit. Sir?
I would like to say one thing. If you look at the panel, we have a very versatile mix of members coming from, you know, craft background, luxury, you know, industry background. Then we have somebody from, you know, one of the top e-commerce, you know, businesses in India. And then we have, you know, from Reliance and all that. So I would like to ask something, because from customer's point of view, and especially from their purchase, you know, point of view, they're buying craft at one side, at the same time they're buying, you know, luxury products. So first question is from the members that how exactly they see the luxury market. So especially maybe you can answer. Luxury market, how they're exactly gearing up to this fast changing, complex, you know, changing lifestyle of people, and how the industry, the luxury industry, is gearing up to, you know, match up with the, you know, people's expectation.
You're right. I think consumers, people, trends, preferences are changing very fast. Our triggers are much wider. It's technology, internet, everything. And so, yes, the pace of change is faster. But it's the same for the brands on the other side of the table. Just as consumers are evolving, we are taking those cues and we're evolving. You have to be very clear which are the cues and the triggers that you're going to act on. I think someone in the last panel said that you need to have a point of view. And for luxury brands, that's very, very true, because we are very strong on heritage, on a particular design philosophy, craftsman, or I would say a brand philosophy that we stand for. That has to be continued. It reacts and it tweaks itself or evolves along with the way the consumer is evolving. But as a luxury brand, and especially Swarovski, which has been over 120 years, we are not going to, you know, just move away from our core brand proposition, because that's what is our asset. And you evolve with the consumer, you figure out which are the areas where you can satisfy the particular consumer demand, which is your core business. So if Swarovski's core business is jewelry, and the consumer preference for jewelry is evolving, we move along with them. But I'm not going to do everything for everyone and dilute my presence.
You think this is one of the stronghold or strong fort in terms of not catering to the masses, something like that?
It's not about not catering to the masses. It is that I play in a particular position and a particular product and a particular technology, particular design philosophy or style. I evolve it on the same lines to how I can broaden it, but I'm not going to do everything for everyone and become a generic brand.
Perfectly. And we know what Swarovski stands for. We've seen, all of us must have seen the stores and the kind of products, just glitters, and, you know, and we always aspire to buy something for someone, you know, for special purposes and special occasions. What I'd like to go to the other end of the products and people's expectation with respect to craft products especially. So how, if you look at a lot of objectives by ministries, Ministry of Textile especially, you know, how do you promote the craft and how do you sync it with the mainstream of buying behavior of, and try to increase the market share for craft products? And so what I would like to specifically ask is, how exactly, as somebody who's been working with craft so closely, would like to give work towards improving the social cause which is related to craft, and especially as a designer, how she really looks up to, at the same time looks up to growing her business in terms of as a craft designer.
You know, firstly, I think even if the craft room goes through retail, talking about the craft room, okay, retailing through and e-commerce. First thing is, what is legal? What is the social responsibility that e-commerce is doing? That is, if Amazon takes, what is going to be their social responsibility? The craftsman would be eager to retail. He is. It is, after all, he's making products and he wants to retail. He wants to reach out to a wider market. the portal is there. What is the social responsibility that any e-commerce is going to put in this portal? It has to be an investment. Yeah.
Also for...
Because it's easy. Because anyone, there are a whole lot of portals that do e-commerce of crafts, which is generally what has happened. It's a craftsman dictates a certain price, they put on a price, they have their own taxation or whatever, they take their own profits, and the craftsman also gets his profit or whatever the prices have. But what is it? I mean, sometimes it is, are they taking the responsibility of shooting and, you know, whole thing that goes into that e-commerce thing. Are they also doing that? Are they going to be responsible for it? It has to be a two-way thing. But people are doing it in small ways now. Stores are doing it for the craft.
So you're saying that e-commerce is one of the biggest engines to drive the craft business growth?
Yeah, it can. It can. It's also a multi-segmented business. Are you talking about cheap? Are you talking about a medium price? Are you talking about a high price thing? But normally a luxury, high price product, someone who goes to purchase that would like to feel, see physically. You know, in craft it becomes a big issue. So what kind of a segment will be retailed from that import? It will be maybe a dupatta, a scarf, you know, of a certain price point, a sari, which a client is aware of, yeah? But having said that, you still have a lot of very expensive bridal wear that is sold through e-commerce. You know, it is still a trial market. People are still finding their way through till they reach a segment.
So, I mean, it's very important to get a point of view from Amazon, I guess, about how, what exactly they feel and what are their, you know, what are, how they are trying to match up with what designers who've been working with craft so closely in a pan-India basis, and how what Amazon at that particular level, what they are trying to, you know, in what respect they're trying to, you know, do a hand-holding.
Okay, I must say something right now. Amazon does not speak about what it does or what happens, so I cannot speak for Amazon right now. I can speak for the idea of what she said about how e-commerce can help people. I think the main thing is, how long are you going to subsidize and fund these people? I think the main thing is, it is getting business to these craft people. It's enabling them to do business and find their own lives. You know, it's not about continuously sustaining their generation and the next generation with subsidy for the next 50 years. I think the thing is, how do you enable them? And I think the problem really has been that while the craftsmen have been working on great stuff, it's the middleman who makes all the money. It's not the craftsman. And the idea is how any e-commerce company can connect the craft people directly to the market. And that is what a marketplace like Amazon does. It will connect it directly for something. But there are mechanisms through which it can be done. You know, mechanisms that I am not at liberty to discuss on behalf of Amazon, but there are mechanisms that can be done, association through designers, parting with people, many different options that can be done. But I think essentially we are looking, you know, we spoke about sustaining craftspeople 30 years ago, 50 years ago. Today, 30 years later, we are still talking about the same thing. And the important thing is, how do you enable their lives so that they are really happy to do? And the only way to do it is to generate business from them.
Sunita, you must have said, if I can summarize that way, what you were saying, the integration of craft with the mainstream fashion business not only provides you an opportunity for the growth of your business, but at the same time, it equally helps the social welfare aspect of the craft.
See, it's also not only social welfare. When you are putting in a design intervention, there's a design intervention in the craft sector, you also upgrade the skill of the craftsman. Okay? Because you're making him work on a high value product. Because that's where we reach a satisfaction. I'm satisfied with the money I get, he's satisfied with the money, apart from all the other satisfactions as well. At the same time, you're also upgrading his livelihood. you know, their aspiration is not like what it used to be earlier. They're not in a black hole. Because everybody is tech savvy, everybody has those mobile phones. In fact, my WhatsApp was downloaded by a craftsman. He said it becomes easier for you instead of just making those trips down there. So they are technologically very savvy, technically very savvy, and their aspirations have changed. Their aspirations are like an aspiration that anyone has. And why shouldn't they have? It's growth and development for everybody. The only thing that we need to know is that we have to educate ourselves and firmly believe in the importance of the craft sector, because that is our heritage and that is our identity. And the way forward is innovation. That's where design is coming. You know, working within the parameters of a craft, because you shouldn't hinder with the identity of any craft. You can't make a phulkari look like a gatha, you know, those kind of things. So generally that is what.
You want to make some
Just another thing that I wanted to add, that every economy goes through a cycle of understanding what where it is. I mean, even in Europe, in the 70s and the 80s, they were all brands, their crafts were all lost. It was just that once the market became mature and people became mature enough to understand the value of these, you see resurgence of brands that have come in. Look at Berluti, look at all the other brands. There are resurgent brands that have come in only because the markets have matured and people understand the value of that product. In India, unfortunately, we are at a different cycle of the economy where we are really discovering and opening ourselves to the world right now. And we're reaching it out in the most convenient and sometimes the most cheapest way, which is China and all of that. But I'm sure there is already a market that is developing in India that understands the value of craft and is willing to pay for something like that.
Can I also say one thing? You know, it's not necessary the development module, what is being successful in the West is going to be good for us. We can have our own module and we are searching and discovering. It's the right time actually for it.
I just wanted to share, in Levi's we launched a range called Khadi Denim, and this was launched in August and it's still there in our stores. And we do very small numbers in that, but it's working with the craftsmen and people in Ahmedabad and nearabouts who are making khadi, indigo khadi denim for us. And this is the first time ever in the history of Levi's, which is like 150 years old, that a hand-spun and hand-woven fabric is being used to manufacture garments. But the most liberating factor for me in this whole journey or this whole initiative is that every single garment has the name of the weaver written inside the garment as a patch. So every garment comes with a unique mention that this has been hand-spun and hand-woven by Mr. Hansukh Lal Mehta, whatever is the name. So every garment is different name there, and it's in a small way we are just helping the craft of India survive. And we had a great amount of pushback from our principals in US when we came up with this idea, because in history of Levi's never ever hand spun hand woven fabric was being used. It was always cone denim and the best mills was, but now this product is available in the vault. So there is a museum in San Francisco which keeps all the denim ever made from 1853 onwards. And made in India khadi is there. So we're very, very proud of that.
Congratulations. And I think that, you know, just as salvaged denim made Japanese denim so big, this is a great opportunity of creating a global brand out of India. Yeah. Salvage denim has become so expensive. It's such premium denim because it's handcrafted. And this is probably one of the ways that one can look at taking Indian craft to another level altogether.
I have an opinion on this. My opinion is that, you know, craft should reach to masses, and it should be the duty and responsibility of the organized trade. You know, if you are doing a block printed range, which you are actually, a design is from the block print, you are doing it on a rotary or you are doing it on a screen for masses to, you know, enjoy that block print trope. The part of a royalty, like a writer gets a royalty on his book. You know, the craft and the organized retail should have that kind of responsibility, that the royalty goes back to the craftsman. This is how, you know, you can actually maximize the generations getting onto the crafts again and again. Otherwise, you are supporting and trying to, you know, make them survive and all that, it's not going to last. It's our responsibility who are in the modern retail. If we are taking the inspiration, the money should go back to them. And that's how I think big money can reach to the craft people and this crafts can keep on growing. This is my opinion about, you know, exactly. Sustaining the crafts.
Something like what crafts were and, you know, everything, whatever we people used to use in their daily life, it was all handcrafted. There was a time, you know, pottery, everything was handcrafted and everything that they needed, they used to just make it. So maybe that thing has to be revived and, you know, and it doesn't have to be just a pity situation where we're going and, you know, every time we say, hey, it has to be, a lot of things have to be done and this and that. We have the main focus, it has to be brought in the mainstream and make more functional products, I guess.
You know, I think it should be a successive collaboration between craftsmen, design and management.
Yeah.
Merchandising, marketing.
Otherwise, it will stay as it is, be like...
That's where NIFT comes into. You know, when you evolve and you know what is the requirement in the market, where you need to focus, what are the things. It's not necessary that you all study abroad in Goa. You can work so much out. Everybody is coming into India to retail because this is where the market is.
I'll give you an example. At Reliance, we have launched a brand known as Siyahi. Now, we take inspirations, we go to, you know, the end of the actual craftsman, you know, pick up the original samples. Then we convert it into a rotary print, taking the inspiration from that, so that our customers can get the feel of those crafts at, you know, affordable prices. And the money which is generated from that is going back to the craftsman as a part of royalty. You know, they are not making all the fabrics for production because it is not sustainable to make that kind of, you know, productivity and do a big retail business. But the inspiration and directions which we are getting, the ideas we are getting, it is going back to the craftsman. So this is how we can promote and have a partnership with the actual craftsman, the modern retail and the consumers.
So, I mean, looking at the scenario, the changing roles and responsibilities from designer's perspective, what do you think should be, as a panel, I would like to ask an answer, like for designers, for the creative professionals, what do you think they should look up to and work towards to make sure that things fall in place? Yeah, I mean, like, anyway, so you can talk from craft perspective, somebody can talk from product, you know. How exactly, what exactly the, you know, the designer, the young alumni and the designer should work towards to make sure that things fall in place.
We'll keep it open for the house also, yeah. If someone from the audience would also like to express their views on this.
You know, first of all, what I can say is, you know, follow your passion. If you have got into this field, this is a great opportunity, this industry, this country as well. You know, this country has got a lot of population. There is a big market for you, as well as there are a lot of people who are going to, you know, create these products for you. So there is a good manufacturing base as well as there is a good market. So there is a huge potential and huge prospects. This is the business where you can make a lot of money. There is a lot of opportunity in this. You know, you have export, you have retail, you have got e-commerce. There is whole lot of, you know, opportunities in this business. The only thing is that you have to follow your passion. You have got into this field, you have got into this, follow it up. There will be ups and downs, there will be stresses, there will be, you know, lot of things which happens in every business, every trade, every kind of career. But stick to it. That's what I can advise on the out of my experience.
Thank you, Shilpi. We'll close it for the day. And some interesting points have come on the basis of the discussions that we have had related to product, craft, home merchandising, detailing, consumer buying behavior. I would like to thank all of you. And now I hand it over to Mr. Hugo.
Thank you very much to our moderators and our panelists.